Hi everyone, this is Bob Whitaker from History Respawned, doing a little bit of streaming tonight of Assassin's Creed Syndicate. This is the new Assassin's Creed game based in Victorian London, 1868 to be exact. And I'm just going to go through and play some of the side missions here, particularly those involving Charles Dickens and Charles Darwin. And also spending some time with some of the I think what they're called is gang activities. Let's see, what are they called? I don't know if they so more of the side quests that involve doing activities in order to take control of the city, including things like Templar hunts, gang strongholds, and then also child liberation. As you can see here, I've already taken over districts of Whitechapel, City of London, and then also to the south, I've taken over Lambeth. But beyond that, I haven't really gone into much of the northern part of the city, Westminster, the Strand, and I've done a little bit in Southwark, but not a lot. So, this is should warn you, this is a late stage, kind of late game playthrough. I'm already I'd say three quarters of the way through the main story, but I don't imagine I'll be going into any of the main story material. But just in case you're worried about some sort of spoilers, then just keep that in mind as I go through. All right, so right now I am playing as Jacob, one of the two protagonists, and I'm going to jump in here and I guess keep playing as Jacob. I've played quite a bit as Evie already, and try some of these missions close by in Whitechapel. See, these missions, they say suggest level 4. I am already level 7, but probably it's not going to be that big of a deal. And I think, let me just see what direction the train is going. It looks like it's going south, so I'm gonna need to jump off in order to reach this. I'm gonna take a moment here just to check the stream, just to see. I've taken a screenshot there instead, just to see if it is streaming on YouTube. Looks like it is. Yeah, okay. Advanced settings include microphone. It looks like I've got everything set up. Okay, so yeah. Jump back into the game. All right. So yeah, I'm gonna jump off the train here and try to get to this mission that's behind me. So this is the train. This is where this kind of serves as the assassin's hideout for this game. And it's kind of neat that you can actually stand in a certain corner along one of the train cars and do some sightseeing where you can watch as things go by on the train. Let me make sure I am all filled out with material. As you can see, I've got quite a bit of money, but surprisingly, the money goes by really fast in this game. I'll hop off the train. It would be nice. I mean, the vehicle inclusion in this game makes it a huge improvement over last Assassin's Creed or previous Assassin's Creed games, but it would be really, really nice if you could tell the train where to go. Unfortunately, that doesn't seem to be an option on this game. You see here, this is the rope launcher, new addition to the game, which, I mean, personally, I think was long overdue. Even though, of course, there's not much historical accuracy to be found with that, but it does make it a lot easier to traverse these cities. And the cities themselves are, you know, fantastically huge, so it really does help to make things quite a bit easier. As you can see, it has a pretty long distance as well. So, let's See, I think I hear another train coming by. Man, it's, yeah, no, it doesn't look like it. I have actually been run over a couple times in my playthroughs by trains, most of which were in train stations, surprisingly, right? But these trains, I don't know if they follow a set pattern or even how many trains are moving through this city. Obviously, London at this time was awash in train stations and rail lines, and it would be very common to see a train passing every few minutes, especially in central London in 1868. So let's see. I think the C stands for Charles Dickens. There is also Charles Darwin, but I think he goes by D. So let's see. I think this is. I'm pretty sure this is Dickens. Yeah, there he is. Okay, so dead letters. So this is one of the Charles Dickens stories. Dickens, of course, 1868. He's 2 years away from passing away from a stroke. So by this time, he's already written most of his famous works: Oliver Twist, Great Expectations, Hard Times, Tale of Two Cities, and so he's, you know, definitely. In terms of public fame, public notoriety, he's without question the Victorian age. And in this game, they have Charles Dickens serving as a quest giver, but particularly somebody who is kind of exploring some of the more, what you might call the kind of spiritual elements of Victorian society. Spiritualism is something that becomes increasingly more popular throughout the Victorian age, particularly with the advent of photography. And it was very common, especially later on in the Victorian era, going into the Edwardian age of you know, seeing early photographic images and people thinking that they had taken a picture of a spirit of some sort. And this was something that I'm not sure if Dickens was really interested in, but it was certainly something that was very popular to think about in the Victorian era. And there was actually a famous controversy in the late 19th century with a couple of girls. I can't remember their names, but they purported to be able to take pictures of not only spirits but also magical fairies. And when in fact most of these photographs they were taking, they had been staged to some extent or another. But spiritualism, belief in the supernatural, beyond traditional religion, very popular in the Victorian era. So Dickens, these missions he's giving here in this game are very, you know, kind of focused on that idea. So let's see what Dickens has to tell us here.
You seem tired, friend. Everything all right?
No rest for the wicked, Charlie.
Today's Ghost Club investigation involves a carriage. It's said to be covered with gold leaf, dazzling passers-by when the sun shines. Naturally, it's rumored to be haunted. Now let's see if we can find it.
Could it be this brightly colored carriage right here? Let's take a look.
I presume this was once used to carry the mail.
So again, these Dickens missions, they focus on giving supernatural quests, and this one seems to be
That actually looks remarkably comfortable.
a Jacob's Wit. This seems to be focused on some sort of magical carriage, and Jacob apparently wants to take a nap. Interesting. All right, it looks like we've got some more clues down here on the ground.
What the devil?
A letter addressed to Jacob, I presume? I guess? I don't know. This is a weird. These Dickens quests are very strange. Hijack. Okay, well, I've got to jump on a carriage. This happens quite a bit in this game where you're forced to catch up to a carriage that's already moving. And these missions are pretty annoying. Again, just to kind of give some historical background, it's great that this game includes carriages, it's great that it includes other vehicles, boats in particular, but in terms of the accuracy of how the city is depicted, the streets in this version of London are much wider than what you would have found in 1868, and it's a kind of conceit made by Ubisoft in order to make the gameplay more attractive. But in the real London in 1868, the streets would have been incredibly narrow, and it would have been difficult to have even two carriages going abreast. So most of the roads would have been one way. Particularly in central London, where space was at a premium. All right, let's see if I can jump across here.
Who's there? Are you a friend?
Yes, madam. Don't worry. You're safe.
All right, so apparently I have to deliver this woman.
That wretch would have forced me to marry him within the hour.
I have no idea what's going on
I
in this
must
quest.
return home.
Some of these side missions, like a lot of Assassin's Creed games before, some of the side missions in Syndicate don't give you a lot of background as to what the heck is actually going on. Luckily, it looks like the objective is pretty close, so we can get out of this mission. Oh, fantastic. Just when I thought I was close to the end of this. Alright, so try not to run into the omnibus. It still is difficult. I mean, I'm a historian of Britain, but it still is difficult for me to remember to drive on the left-hand side of the road. Some habits are hard to break. So the ramming of carriages works pretty well. I've got to make sure. And it has a feel that's really similar to Assassin's Creed 4, with the use of ships and whatnot. I think I'm gonna have to get out. Sometimes these carriages, even though the roads are incredibly wide, sometimes these carriages get stuck on obstacles on the side of the road. So looks like that's the end of it, hopefully. I don't know if I have an objective. Okay, here we go.
We've lost them. Thank you. You have been a great help.
Again,
Will you please
get
let me
on the left-hand side, Bob.
I owe you my thanks. You have gone to a great deal of trouble for someone you don't even know. What is your name?
Jacob Fry, miss.
So this is, I'm picking up on these side missions, Dickens side missions. Pretty late in the game, I'd say I'm three quarters of the way through the story missions. But I just wanted to take some time to go through the Dickens and Darwin missions tonight to see how they betray these historical figures.
I am Elizabeth. Won't you climb down and sit beside me so that I might see your face?
What a strange mission this is. Okay, I guess I've got to go around the side.
Miss? Where are you?
Weird. Okay, so apparently she was a ghost. these Dickens missions, again, they're drawing upon the interest in Victorian society with the supernatural.
You look as though you're just about to collapse. What on earth has happened?
But even for all that supernatural interest and backing, this is a really, really strange set of missions that Dickens gives you. Okay, well, at least I got the full synchronization with that mission. I've actually followed around Dickens and Darwin. I've run into Darwin in the city while they've just been walking around, and then I've also ran into Karl Marx outside of missions. And it seems like their subroutines are pretty well mapped out by Ubisoft, which is pretty impressive. It gives it an air of believability. And the same could be said of some of these other NPCs walking around the city. For instance, I followed a couple of people who looked like they were using the omnibuses, the large horse-drawn carriages to go to work. So pretty neat, pretty excellent work, I'd say, by Ubisoft. I mean, in terms of, you know, the just kind of general historical feel to the city, it feels pretty accurate. You know, some of the characterizations of the historical figures, like Dickens and Darwin, are a little odd. So let's see, we've gotten a taste of what the Dickens missions are like. Let's go and check out Darwin. This is another mission that's in Whitechapel, the far eastern district of London. It's famous in the 1870s for the Jack the Ripper murders. And this game taking place in 1868. I don't think it includes any sort of mention of Jack the Ripper, although I do think there is a series of murder mysteries that you can pick up. So perhaps Jack the Ripper will be the basis for a DLC. That's what I'd imagine. So, let's see. Dickens and Darwin. Darwin represented with a D. They're both Charles, so I guess you just have to pick one to be C and the other one to be D. So Darwin is down here. Darwin, if you haven't played the game, it gives you a set of story missions involving tainted medicine, poisoned medicine, earlier on in the game. And so now he's giving side quests, non-story mission side quests, and most of them involve protecting Darwin from his critics, who are being marshaled up by the Templars to attack his ideas on evolution. And, you know, the game takes place in 1868. Darwin published On the Origin of Species in 1859. And his writing by the late 1860s, I would say, is gaining quite a bit of traction. I wouldn't say that everybody in society necessarily agrees with him. But definitely scientists, naturalists who are working in Britain buy into his ideas of evolution by the late 1860s. But he still has his critics, and most of his critics are from a religious background. And some of them are fellow scientists who just they can't square the idea of evolution alongside a belief in God. Which is something that Darwin had worried about when he first published On the Origin of Species, but he was somebody who really, you know, from what we know about his diary, you know, from his diaries, from his correspondence now, he is somebody who really enjoyed controversy. He's somebody who really enjoyed public debate. So, you know, he knew that The Origin of Species was going to be incredibly controversial, and even though he had to put up with a lot of harassment throughout Victorian society, what we know now, it seems like he actually enjoyed it. So, all right, let's see what this Darwin quest is going to be.
My young friend, today's papers carry a rebuttal of Mr. Owen's slanderous and ignorant remarks about my work. However, I'm feeling quite like a fossil today.
So,
would you be a dear and get me a copy of the
he
newspaper?
Is the Mr. Owen he's referring to is a guy named Richard Owen, who is a Victorian scientist who's depicted in this game as kind of a Templar agent. And Richard Owen was a contemporary of Charles Dickens. He was another famous biologist, naturalist, scientist. He is the person who came up with the word dinosaur. But Owen, unlike Darwin, was somebody who didn't agree with the idea of evolution or natural selection, and openly criticized Charles Darwin. And it was really Richard Owen who was perhaps the most famous critic of Darwin, and he took to attacking Darwin through newspapers, but also through various scientific journals. And the basis for his disagreement with Darwin had to do with the lack of a fossil record for the theory of evolution, as I just get run over by a carriage. I have no idea what is going on. Good Lord! I think that carriage is going to make me... Oh my gosh, this is some horrendous open world jank here. It's going to make me miss this, screw up this mission. Let's see if I can catch back up to him. Gosh, that was weird. Again, this is an Ubisoft game, so perhaps it's not surprising that there's some difficulty with the open world here. There he is. Again, Richard Owen, one of the great critics of Charles Darwin. Again, another carriage. What on earth is going on? This is crazy. This is not, if you haven't played this game, this getting run over by carriages like that is not typical. So I have no idea what's going on. Again, Richard Owen, in this quest, apparently has written some more diatribes against Darwin in a local newspaper, and we're chasing down somebody who is perhaps helping Owen in his criticism of Darwin. I hate these Assassin's Creed missions where you have to tackle somebody.
Saved my life.
Yes. Now here's a question for you. Why would you attack a newsboy?
A man paid me and my mates to force newsboys to display this leaflet. Yeah, take the bloody thing and leave me alone.
This spells trouble for Mr. Darwin.
So you can see this caricature. This leaflet that the Templars are passing out on Darwin. So this is portraying Darwin as a monkey, as you can see from the leaflet over there to the right. He's got his regular head with his massive Victorian beard, but he's got a monkey's body. And this was a common caricature to see of Darwin in the 1860s. Again, Origin of Species, published 1859, and the initial criticism of Darwin, besides a religious one, is that he was making the argument that, or at least people thought he was making the argument that man was directly descended from monkeys, which of course is not the argument of the Origin of Species. But this was an easy way for people to mischaracterize and criticize his work. And the monkey image of Darwin is perhaps one that you would see, you know, in the early 1860s. But again, by this time, by the time this game is set, 1868, it would be very likely that these images would be going out of favor because the majority of people in London and certainly throughout Britain were beginning to agree with Darwin's ideas. So let's see. We've gotten a look at Darwin. We've gotten a look at Dickens. I think we've completed all of those missions in Whitechapel. So let's go down. Let's go down south of the river and take a look at some of the missions involving Karl Marx. So I'm going to jump to one of these viewpoints. Again, quest givers in this game, we've had Dickens, Charles Dickens, Charles Darwin. Now we're going to take a look at Karl Marx. And Karl Marx, of course, famous for communist ideology, Marxist ideology. And Marx, again, originally from Germany, from Prussia. He had moved to France in the 1840s, attempted to incite a socialist revolution in France in 1848, which failed. And after 1848, he was forced into exile. And he settled in England, not necessarily hoping to stay there, but hoping to use England as a base from which to publish more diatribes against the ruling classes in Europe and try to incite some sort of general revolution. He ends up living the remainder of his life in exile in England. And he spends most of his time working with Frederick Engels, who was a relatively wealthy business owner, industrialist from the age, but also somebody who agreed with Marx's ideology, his ideas, and helped to support Marx financially while Marx wrote a lot of his great works in Britain in the 1850s, 1860s. And in 1867, Marx has begun work on his magnum opus, Das Kapital. And so here we are in 1868, and Marx is working with the assassins to help the downtrodden living in London society. So you might ask, you know, why did they allow this revolutionary Karl Marx to live in their country? Well, it was because the English were, or the British in general, were pretty confident that they could control their working classes. They didn't have to worry too much about revolution. And they loved to grant asylum to various nonconformists from the continent, from their European rivals, because it was kind of like sticking a thumb in their eyes, you know, to take in a revolutionary from France, to give a revolutionary from Germany asylum in Britain, was essentially to say that France and Germany couldn't control their own population, but that Britain could not only control their population, but, you know, be kind of worthy enough or liberal enough to grant these potential subversives asylum. It was to make Britain seem like the greater state compared to their continental rivals. All right, so actually this doesn't involve Karl Marx. This involves a friend of Karl Marx, Frank Morris, who's been acquiring dynamite. And originally his plan was to destroy the Houses of Parliament. And what's interesting about this Morris quest line is that it really represents pretty well what's going on between Marx and other revolutionary groups in the 1860s going forward. Initially, Marx, when he was living in France, living on the continent, he was somebody who advocated the use of violence in order to overthrow the capitalist system. But by the late 1860s, he sees the use of violence as being counterproductive. And it's at this point that Marx is, you know, moving away from the ideology that's purported by a lot of anarchists on the continent. He's not necessarily advocating nonviolence, but he's saying that if you use dynamite, if you use terrorist tactics, you're probably not going to achieve the, you know, the victory of the proletariat. So let's see what Frank Morris wants us to do here.
They're moving the shipment, but we must go now. There's a carriage on the next corner. If we hide within, they'll drive us right to it.
I'll hide inside it. You're going home.
Home? Back to a cold and cheerless house where I'll wear black gloves and sport a weed on my hat for a year. Then I'll return to the factory like a small cog in the great wheel of capital. No, I want justice. I must have those explosives.
Nobody's laying their hands on the nitro, chum. Not you, not them, nobody. Enough blood's been spilled already.
I am trying to build a better world, to ensure that no one suffers what my son did. Pray tell me, friend, how much blood do you consider that to be worth?
So again, it seems like Frank is not giving up on the idea of blowing up Parliament, but from the perspective of Marx, and it appears the assassins, that kind of violent activity should be discouraged.
They drive me to this factory.
All right, let's jump inside here. This is interesting. This is two missions in a row, which I've had to hide inside of a carriage. A little bit strange.
Well, they'll never get hold of it now.
Bleeding anarchists. Couldn't organize a piss-up in a brewery.
So, again, this is a Marx mission, but this is involving Frank Morris, who is more of an anarchist compared to Marx. By the 1860s, Marx is looking to discourage violent activities in favor of using traditional politics to overthrow capitalism. And really, you know, the kind of use of dynamite in terrorist activities for anarchists is not really popularized until the late 1880s. It starts in France, eventually used in Germany. So this is a little outside of the historical record here to have Morris using dynamite to attack Parliament. That's more of something you would have seen out of Europeans in the 1870s, 1880s, 1890s. Let's see. Use nitroglycerin. Okay, well, I guess I just hop out here. I probably should have used Evie for this mission simply because.
Sorry, but my need is greater than you know.
Oh, that guy's stealing TNT again. Whoop. Well, maybe not.
All right. Gonna smash these crates before anyone else gets any bright ideas.
Okay, well, that does it for Frank Morris's plot to blow up Parliament. Gosh, that was something straight out of Red Dead Redemption there, getting a box of dynamite and then getting shot while holding it. So let's see, kill the Templars using... So let's carry this. Oh, well, nope, I just ignited it, crap. I don't think that took out anybody. Okay. These button prompts are sometimes difficult to keep track of. I would say on the whole, regarding combat, the combat is a little bit easier to deal with in Syndicate compared to last year's Unity. Certainly the game's counter system, I think, is a lot better than Unity's, and as you can see, there's quite a bit more in terms of finishing moves that you can complete. Okay, let's see if I can't grab... Let's see, where are the deposits? Okay, so there's one down there. Let me see if I can't grab that and then use it to blow up some of these guys. Oh, well, I took out that innocent bystander. I'm sorry. Alright, let's see. We've got how many more? Looks like three. There's another one. Alright, let's jump into back into the building and then maybe take out this guy before moving on to more explosives. Really handy technique in this game is to attack the Templars, particularly in stealth missions like this, using the whistle technique. Using the whistle feature, I shouldn't say it's a technique. That seems to be a good way to avoid being detected, yet also taking out a bunch of Templars. So let's see if I can. Sometimes the traversal in this game is a little bit difficult. I don't know if I can. They take out anybody using this. Let's see if I can just carry this. I don't know what the distance is for throwing the boxes. It's not fantastic. Let me see if I can't move a little bit closer. Hey, Michael. How and when did I get into Assassin's Creed? Well, I started playing Assassin's Creed with the second game. I didn't go back and play the first game until I'd completed. I think I hadn't played Brotherhood. Let's see if I can get there. That worked pretty well. All right, so if I get two more using Nitroglycerin, I get the bonus. I loved the second game. I think it's still one of the best games in the series, despite the technological limitations. Assassin's Creed 1, if I had played Assassin's Creed 1 before I'd played 2, I don't know if I would have actually ended up playing the rest of the series. I think Assassin's Creed 1 is a really excellent proof of concept for the series, but in terms of gameplay, it's kind of a miserable experience. And certainly I wouldn't recommend people to go back and play it now. It just is too old. The mechanics are pretty awful. But definitely, you know, obviously my interest in history has kind of led me to keep playing these games, but I'd say that in terms of, you know, the games and the quality, I'd say, you know, Assassin's Creed 2, Assassin's Creed Brotherhood are kind of the highlights of the series. And I would say that you could definitely, at this point, if you haven't played them already, you could definitely afford to skip the first game. And probably Assassin's Creed Revelations, which is set in Istanbul. But the other games, I'd say, are worth playing. You know, a lot of people have problems with... let's see, now I'm being told to go and talk to Marx. A lot of people have problems with Assassin's Creed 3, which is set during the American Revolution. I think that game does an excellent job with some of the historical characters, but I would agree with a lot of people that Assassin's Creed 3 is probably one of the worst playing Assassin's Creed games. Obviously Black Flag was a lot of fun. I've done a video on History Respawn about that, I think does a good job of explaining why that game succeeds beyond the fact that it's just fun to play as a pirate. Last year's Unity, I thought, is, you know, was an okay game, but of course it had a lot of technological challenges, a lot of glitches, a lot of bugs, which thankfully this game, Syndicate, in my playthrough, I played about 15 to 17 hours of this game so far. I haven't run into any of those glitches or bugs, so that's a nice improvement. So here, let's see what Karl Marx has to tell us.
Mr. Morris, I see. I was afraid it would come to this. He was a good man, but even the best of us can lose our way when blinded by grief. Still, I thank you for preventing a greater tragedy.
So again, Marx in this game is portrayed as somebody who wants to avoid violence, but wants to still help workers throughout the city of London. And I think this is actually one of the more accurate parts of the game in terms of the historical record, because by the 1860s, certainly by the late 1860s, when Marx is writing Das Kapital, you know, he has moved away from the idea of using violence to incite revolution. It might just be because of old age, but, you know, from Marx's perspective, the use of violence almost always dilutes the strength of the revolution. It almost always makes the revolution about the violence rather than about the goals, which is the establishment of a communist state, of a proletariat state. So I think this is one of the things that the game gets right, certainly for Marx in the 1860s. All right, so that mission was a little weird. We saw somebody blown up carrying a crate of dynamite. let me check out, let's see, I've gotten some more skill points. Let me check out my skills here and see if there's any more upgrades. Again, as you can see, I'm about 44% synchronized in the game. I've played about 15 to 17 hours, but I'd say that I've not really done a lot of story missions. Most of that is side content. So let's see what kind of skill upgrades I can get here. I filled out, this is Jacob again, and he's more combat focused. As you can see, I've filled out Jacob's branch. I guess stealth is really kind of Evie's thing. So I guess I'm just going to put some points into the ecosystem branch if I can't. Well, it looks like I don't have enough, except for driver, to accelerate significantly faster. Why not? Sure. Nope. I've got some Ubisoft points as well. Unfortunately, those are still a part of the Assassin's Creed series. I've never used them myself, but I suppose they make somebody happy. Let's see, I've got 5,400 pounds. I don't know if there's really anything that I can upgrade that's worthwhile. What's great about this game, and it's something that Unity had used as well, is that you can make a lot of your purchases, both in equipment and in goods, from the pause menu. You don't have to go to a particular store. So it really kind of speeds up the amount of upgrades that you can get, because it was always the case with me with earlier Assassin's Creed games that I would forget to go and visit a store and never really make any upgrades. But with the ability to make these purchases in the pause menu, it really saves you a lot of time. So let's see, I suppose I should upgrade my gang a little bit, and I think, let's see, Rook Reiners, I don't have enough for that. Allies in Arms, open fire, okay, yeah. Having them with guns would be a lot more useful. You see up there, it's up to the right, you've got the different items needed to upgrade, especially for the gang upgrades. And the one that always comes at a premium is metal, which you can see I've got a whole ton of the other goods, but not much metal. So I'll have to use 52 here, or 50 out of the 92, but hopefully I can find some more side quests that can give me some more metal. Let's see. All right. Well, still have a little bit of money left over. Let me see if I can't upgrade some of the weapons here. So one of the, I think, a clever addition by Ubisoft in this game is to make one of the weapon fields the sword cane, which is kind of the classic Victorian steampunk weapon. You've got a whole list of different sword canes that you can use and upgrade. And this is kind of the weapon used by Evie, whereas Jacob is more about these knuckles, brass knuckles. So I'm going to hold on to the money for now. And let's see if I can't find another side activity to do. Actually, why don't we, let's see, I'll change character, I'll change the Eevee, and I'll do one of these stealth missions. Don't necessarily have to do some of these missions using stealth, but they typically end better if you can. So one of the kind of stealth categories for side missions are these child liberation missions. So let me jump into one of these. So a big part, again, this game is set in 1868, and a big part of this game is the idea that you are fighting as the assassins, you're fighting for the downtrodden, the poor, the working class in London society. But what's interesting is that, you know, Ubisoft has decided to set this game in 1868, which was actually a moment in time in which the downtrodden in London were actually enjoying an upswing. 1866, you see passage of several acts that limit child labor, and 1867 sees the passage of the Second Reform Act, which for the first time in English society allows for a large number of working class men to vote in parliamentary elections. So what's interesting about 1868 is, you know, Ubisoft has portrayed this ongoing class warfare, but actually by 1868 in London in particular, things were actually getting much better for the working class, particularly when you compare that to what's going on with the working classes in places like Germany and in France, Italy, and then also to a certain extent in the United States. So, you know, the treatment of workers, if you were to go off this game, it's pretty terrible. But in terms of this actual period in British history, things have gotten noticeably better by 1868. And what's interesting is that the fact that things have gotten better actually takes a lot of the wind out of the sails of critics of the British state, particularly people like Karl Marx. And one of the reasons why he, you know, really kind of dedicates himself to writing Das Kapital is because he thinks that he's not going to gain much ground trying to incite an actual revolution in Britain, because the British state has gotten pretty good about actually, you know, kind of placating the desires of the British working class. So let's see, we got a question here. Do you know anything about gangs during the Victorian era? So there are two main gangs that are featured in this game. There are the Blighters, which are the Templar group. And then there is, let's see if we got a watcher up there, a sniper. And then there is the Rooks. And as far as I know, the Blighters were an actual London gang. I don't know about the Rooks. So in terms of the Templar gang, the Templar faction, the Blighters are an actual gang from this time period. But the Assassins group called the Rooks, I have no idea. But, you know, gangs were a major part of urban centers throughout the modern era, especially in the UK. And typically these gangs, just like gangs today, they centered on different districts in town. But what's interesting about, you know, these gangs in the 19th century is that even though they, you know, often featured young adults as members, these young adults were also typically workers. So the gangs in Victorian society, and this would have been true also in other places in the 19th century, they would not just be localized to a certain area of town, but they would sometimes also be localized to a certain class of worker. So you'd have gangs that would center around, say, people working in the coal industry, or gangs centered around people working in the steel mills. So that kind of, it kind of makes it a bit different from gangs that you see today, which are, you know, primarily based off of where you live. In the Victorian era, they would have also been based off of, you know, who you worked with. So let's see if I can't take care of these snipers here. Evie is a better character for these type of missions because the child liberation missions, they include alarms throughout the locations, so if you're playing as Jacob, you're more likely to be detected, and the alarms go off, and it makes the mission much more difficult. Oh, good, a crate of dynamite in the factory. I'm sure that's well-placed. okay, let's see. How many more do I have to take out here? Maybe a night in the pit would inspire you. I have not seen the foreman yet. So, again, like I said, the laws against child labor had been passed in England starting in 1866. And this law in 1866, it only applied to factories that employed more than 50 people. So what you see here in this game, we've got you know, factories that only include children. Those would have never existed. Unless you were working in an industry that required small hands, you would never have factories that only had children laborers. But with that said, you know, these factories, they are definitely less than 50 people. So technically, these factories being run by the Templars in this game are actually perfectly legal. Based on the Victorian laws at the time. So it's kind of an interesting thing that, you know, child labor was definitely a point of contention in Victorian society, but the factories being portrayed in this game, according to Victorian law at the time, were perfectly fine. Nothing wrong with these. And, you know, it's only in the Victorian era that we have this sort of criticism of child labor. You know, obviously today it seems like one of these horrific things, but you know, throughout the majority of human history, children had been working as agricultural laborers. They'd been working without pay for their families, working in family workshops, and it's only with the Victorian age that we get this development that you know, children should be looked after, that they should have an actual childhood. So that's quite a bit different from our modern perspective. You know, the Victorian age in terms of morality is pretty similar to what we have today throughout most of the world. But again, you've got to keep in mind that this was really the first age in which people showed much care or much worry for downtrodden classes, and that included children. So, let's see. Let me need to make sure. Okay, so I've got workers. Are they? Those are not children. Those are definitely adults. But are they listed as children? Let's see. Oh, these are rooks. Sorry. Okay, well, I was attempting to save my own gang members from the clutches of the Templars. They're not at all at risk. All right, I've taken out the foreman. Now I'm going to make my way over to the other children. Let's see. So Michael again asks, which subjects in history are you versed in? Are there any settings you'd like to see this series explore? So my PhD is in British history, modern British history, and I'm focused in particular on the British Empire. And what's interesting to me is that the British Empire despite being a major part of Britain's economic success, their political success at this time in 1868, the British Empire is hardly mentioned in this game at all. There is, of course, the presence of Henry Green from India, who's an assassin that helps you throughout this game, but beyond Henry Green, there's really no mention whatsoever of the Empire. There is some look at maps from the time period that show the British Empire, but it's really not brought up at all. So I would say, as a modern British historian, I would have loved to have seen a game based on British history that actually dealt with the Empire. Now, I'd say that there is supposedly a new Assassin's Creed game coming out, a downloadable game, that's going to be set in India during the 18th century. So there was supposed to be a series of games released this year called Assassin's Creed Chronicles. The first game came out, I think it was in February or March, and that game was set in early modern China and during the Ming Dynasty. And the second game was supposed to be set in India, but it wasn't released this year. So we'll see if that comes out. So that might be an opportunity to get some content on the British Empire. But I don't have high hopes at this point. I think one of the reasons why Ubisoft didn't end up releasing those games this year is because they had to spend so much time fixing Assassin's Creed Unity. In addition to fixing Unity, I'm sure they pulled a lot of people from development of that game because they wanted to make sure that Syndicate turned out to not have any errors. All right, let's see. All right, so we got a question. One of the assassins, Henry Green, is from British India. How often did Indians travel and live in the UK at this time? It was pretty common for Indians to live in major port cities, major political centers in the UK, like London. Liverpool would have been another destination for Indians, living in the UK at this time. Edinburgh, to a certain extent. But definitely any port cities within the UK, you would have had an Indian presence. And certainly with the Indian travelers moving to the UK, they would have all been of the very highest caste. They would have been people of very high social background, of great economic status. And you see this a bit in the game. Henry Green is familiar with a Maharaja, the king of a princely state in India. And he makes an appearance at one point in an Eevee mission in this game. And so that would have been the type of person that you would have seen from India in the UK at this time. But it would have been more common than you see in this game. In this game, when you're just walking down the streets, it is very rare to see anybody who is not English. And that is very strange because, London at this time is, one of the centers of world trade. It's one of the great centers of international politics. And so to not have people from outside of England, particularly in London, particularly around the docks on the Thames, is very odd. So that's what I would say. There should be more people from India in this at this time. Did you watch Fem Frequency review on the game? I did. I watched that this morning. And yeah, I thought the review was pretty good. I mean, I think Anita Sarkeesian, her kind of take on the game wasn't that surprising if you're familiar with Feminist Frequency on the whole. I think she did a really good job of reviewing what makes Eevee a really interesting and special character. And, you know, honestly, I mean, regardless of what your politics are, I think it's really refreshing to have a female protagonist. I mean, even if you are diametrically opposed to Femme Frequency or to Anita Sarkeesian in particular, you know, it's just refreshing to have somebody who is not just a static, you know, Assassin's Creed protagonist. And I think, you know, a lot of the points that Anita makes in that video are well taken, and I think it's for the benefit not just of, you know, her agenda, but then also players themselves. I mean, it's great. I think it's great to have more diversity on these types of games. And I think Evie, honestly, is a really pretty cool character. Alright, so Matthew asks, at this time, how was the air quality from all the factory coal burning? Yeah, it was pretty terrible. Like modern-day Beijing, or like it is in the game? So, not nearly as bad as modern-day Beijing, because with Beijing, you're not just getting pollution from coal burning, but you're also getting pollution from the burning of gasoline and oil. So modern-day Beijing is actually many, many, many times worse than what you would have ever encountered in London. But London at this time, as you can see, just spanning over the cityscape, you know, pretty accurate portrayal of what the city would have looked like with all the coal burning. And certainly at this time, the CO2 levels are rising. You have the beginning of acid rain in London, at least by the 1880s. I don't know about 1868, but London, as an industrial center, has been burning coal since the late 1700s. So certainly by this time, if you were in a major city like London, you're going to be assaulted with heavy coal deposits in the air. You're going to have black soot on your face if you're walking through one of these industrial centers. And just like people in Beijing, it probably would not have been a bad idea to wear some sort of mask. But with that said, if you were outside of major cities like London or Manchester or Liverpool, you would not have to deal with that same sort of level of smog or pollution. But if you're in modern-day Beijing, that type of pollution can spread beyond the city center, particularly because of internal combustion engines and cars. Whereas in the industrial era in London, the pollution would have been centralized to the factory areas, to the coal burning areas. So if you're out in the countryside, your health would probably be just fine. All right, let's see. So the Marx mission is just right below me. So again, I'm just trying to play through some of the side quests, taking a look at the missions given by people like Charles Dickens and Charles Darwin in this game. So here's Karl Marx again. Let's see if he's got anything new to tell us.
Corruption reigns here, I'm sure of it. The number of people injured by their machinery cannot be calculated, and yet the company continues to prosper. They must be stopped for the sake of the poor workers they abuse. If only we had some form of proof. There must be records of the accident somewhere inside, which would surely prove their malfeasance. I should think you'd need to find the foreman. But how you'd convince him to give you the reports? Perhaps if they think the factory's on fire, you might bluff your way past.
Interesting. So, he wants me to infiltrate a textile factory in London. And textiles at this time are one of the leading industries in Britain. And textiles, again, these are not just the manufacturing clothes, this could be a manufacturing of sails, and any woven goods would have been considered part of the textile industry. So still a major industry, and this is really the industry that helped the Industrial Revolution get started in Britain. the textile industry, you know, not much cotton, not much woven material is actually grown in Britain. And so most of the cotton that they're getting comes from places like the United States. It comes from India as well. And Britain is where they are taking that raw material and they are processing it in huge factories. So this is where, you know, the influence of the British Empire is really felt, because Britain is in possession of one of the major textile producing, or I should say, cotton producing countries in India. And they also have a very close economic relationship with the United States. So to have a textile factory in London would have been very common at this time, though most of the major factories throughout the country were actually in the north, in places like Liverpool and Manchester. Though in 1868, it wouldn't have been uncommon for London to also have quite a few of these factories, and the factories would have been located in port cities, because you're not getting the cotton from London itself, but you're getting it from India, from the United States. And you can see here, we're in the factory, we're in the cotton factory, so they're taking raw cotton, and they've got these mechanical loom weavers that are turning the cotton into textile, into fabric. So you could see the cotton there with the ignite sign. You could see the cotton is packed up. So what they would do is they would unpack the cotton. It's usually one person, the overseer, the foreman, would unpack the cotton, and then the factory attendants, the people working the machines, would take the cotton and feed that into the loom machines. So this is all work that would have been done in previous centuries before the Industrial Revolution by hand. You know, in particular using a spinning wheel, like in Rumpelstiltskin. But now with the development of steam engines, with the development of industrial technology, all of this work can be done by machine, and it can be done incredibly quickly. So let's see. I want to see. So I'm supposed to be completing a mission here, but I'm interested in the makeup of this factory. So you can see here, if we look at this machine just right in front of us here, we've got a loom machine that has been run on a pulley, and the gears for that pulley, the shaft there, is being run up against the wall. So this is a pretty common setup for cotton factories in the 19th century, where you've got multiple machines that are all connected along the same track. So all of the gear shafts are along the same track, and all those gear shafts are being powered usually by a steam engine, which is located outside of the factory itself. And you would want the steam engine to be located outside the factory, because if something went wrong with the coal, if you know there was a fire or something like that, you might lose the engine, but you wouldn't lose the entire factory, and you wouldn't lose all of the natural resources that you've got piled up in here, like the cotton. So speaking of avoiding accidents, I'm now going to try to set fire to some of these cotton bales within this factory. Let's see, these guys in blue, I'm not sure if they're actually enemies. It's kind of hard to tell. I know the guys in red are. Maybe I'll just jump down here and see what's what. Yeah, Michael, I am still looking. I've already collected material for Red Dead Redemption. I have captured a lot of footage from my 360 copy of the game. But unfortunately, I have yet to find a historian that'll talk to me about the game. And it's not from a lack of trying. So I am definitely attempting to do Red Dead Redemption, but unfortunately, it's not always easy to just find a historian that'll help you with that kind of stuff. Oh boy, well, I've made a mistake and was unable to maintain stealth, so now I'm just going to kind of quickly rush through here and try to burn the rest of this cotton. Alright, there we go. Looks like there's another bale outside. Yeah, so in terms of future games for History Respawn on YouTube, we are about to release an episode on Bioshock Infinite. I am working on trying to find somebody for somebody to talk to for Red Dead. And after that, we really don't have any plans. We've got a long list of potential games, but it's really a matter of what games we can find a historian for, because we've got the ability to capture material for just about everything. But in terms of future games, some of the ones that are interesting to me, maybe doing an episode here on Syndicate, but also doing one on a game just came out for PC called 80 Days, which is based off of the old Jules Verne story, 80 Days Around the World. And there's a couple of historians, one of whom is at Harvard, just came out with a recent book about the idea of circumnavigating the globe in the Industrial Age. And so I'd really like to get her to talk about that game, 80 Days, for a future episode, hopefully pretty soon. But the great thing about recent video games is that there seems to be a predilection for historical games. So there's really been any number of opportunities. I'm going to steal this guy's wagon so I can get to this fire truck faster. Really any number of opportunities to deal any number of episodes to deal with historical material in assess or in for History Respawn. Again, carriages, horse riding is a new addition to the series. I think it's a really welcome addition. It really adds a lot to the historical authenticity of the Assassin's Creed games. But I would say that the roads that Ubisoft has created in this version of London are much wider than the London streets that you would have seen in the real London in 1868. So this is the first time I've actually ridden one of these fire engines. Try not to create too much destruction. It's interesting, you actually you can get a bonus for creating a lot of destruction and mayhem while driving in Assassin's Creed Syndicate. I haven't gotten that achievement yet, but if you just simply run over things like lampposts, you get this wanton destruction perk that pops up. So if you're feeling the itch to act as though you're in Grand Theft Auto while playing Assassin's Creed, they've got a perk that'll allow you to do that.
What about any reports? We must get them out of there before the fire takes them.
Mother of God, you're right. Follow me, quickly.
So unfortunately, during this era in history, these types of industrial disasters with fires and the destruction of machines were all too common. And with societies like the United States, Britain, and Germany, and other major industrial societies, there wasn't the type of business regulations that you see today, as far as worker safety, as far as worksite safety. So these types of fires, unsafe working conditions, again, would have been very commonplace in major industrial cities during the 19th century. So let's see, I'm supposed to steal something from the foreman. Apparently this is more difficult than I thought it was going to be. It looks like the foreman is following a set path. Let's see if I can't catch him while he's vulnerable. I'm playing a kind of a late stage playthrough of this game. I'm about 3/4 of the way through the story mission. And oh boy. Okay, well, so much for stealth. Sorry, Metropolitan Police. A brief word about the Met. So, London Metropolitan Police founded in 1829, these guys in the blue uniforms, and they were kind of the first true modern police force. There were the French National Police, which were founded during the Napoleonic era, but it was the Met that was the really first true independent from the military police established in the world. And again, they were founded in 1829. At first, they were incredibly controversial because people in London, particularly the working classes in London, felt that the Metropolitan Police were designed to not combat crime, but to control the working classes, to control the major population centers. So in order to dissuade people from this notion, Robert Peel, who developed the Metropolitan Police, he decided to dress them in blue uniforms and to make their uniforms incredibly ostentatious, really conspicuous. And the reason for this is because he wanted them first to wear uniforms so that people wouldn't assume that the police were designed to be spies. Because the idea was that if you had plain clothes policemen, they could infiltrate labor unions, they could infiltrate different worker organizations, and they could potentially disrupt those organizations. So Robert Peel with the Met, he wanted them to wear blue uniforms so that everybody would know what they were and so that they couldn't go sneaking around without being seen. And he wanted to make sure that the uniforms were blue because even though red was a really popular color for official work in Britain, red was associated with the British Army, the famous red coats that the British Army wore in the 18th through the early 19th century. So the London Metropolitan Police, they wore uniforms, and they wore blue uniforms so that they weren't associated with the British Army. And the Met, they were incredibly unpopular until the 1850s. And it was in the 1850s that the public began to accept the Metropolitan Police as a useful good, as something that it was helping to make their society better. And by the 1860s, the Met had developed kind of a, you know, enough of a professional clout to be respected not just by the ruling classes, but also by common citizens. But that took a long time. And, you know, the thing is that, you know, a lot of people that I teach, you know, modern British history, they always seem surprised that the police as an idea, you know, has only been around for a little over 100 years, right? Metropolitan Police was founded in 1829. Most people, most students that I teach, they assume that the police have been around since, you know, at least the 1700s, if not earlier. But the police, the Met, kind of the first modern police force, is a wholly modern invention, developed in 1829. And something that I would say is still, you know, the idea of police, the idea of kind of a standing army within a city, is something that's new. It's still in a state of becoming, not only in Britain, but United States and elsewhere. I should also say, initially, many members of the London police, the Metropolitan Police, they carried weapons. Of course, today they're famous for being one of the world's unarmed police forces. But in the mid-19th century, going into the 1870s, many members of the London Metropolitan Police, they carried swords. Many of them carried, short swords. Sometimes the detectives carried pistols. So, this notion of the London Met being unarmed is something that didn't really come into being until the late 19th century. Going into, again, they were founded in 1829. Going into 1830s, 1840s, 1850s, many members of the London Met would have been armed. So it's not a police force that, was known for being unarmed until later on in the 19th century. So let's see, I'm going to do one more Marx mission and then sign off for the evening. Let's see what Marx has got in store for us now. Again, I think the portrayal of Marx in this game, as I just get hit by a random carriage, I think the portrayal of Marx in this game is a little strange, if only because he's kind of portrayed as a bit of a buffoon that's constantly hanging out at pubs, when in fact Marx was a coffee drinker. He didn't really drink alcohol that much, despite being a German. So the caricature of him in this game is a little bit weird, but I'd say that the kind of general gist of his missions, his desire to remain nonviolent, even though he was revolutionary, is pretty well portrayed by Ubisoft in this game.
I'm so relieved to have found you. I fear my upcoming meeting is going to be disrupted. Strikebreakers, maybe, or police spies. Ruffians who fear the march of progress.
Fear not, Mr. Marx. I'll look after you.
I worry that any agitation will incite terrible violence, so please remove troublemakers without attracting any attention. Wunderbar. Thank you. I must prepare, but I will see you inside shortly.
So again, we've got Marx worried that a strike is going to be broken up by troublemakers, by people who are going to create violence. And this, again, is a pretty accurate portrayal of where Marx's thinking is at this point. Earlier on in his life, certainly when he was living in France, he advocated the use of violence. But by the time you get to Marx in the 1860s, he's attempting to avoid that kind of violence because he sees it as counterproductive. He sees it as something that discourages the workers. And I'm supposed to kidnap these guys, but unfortunately I've tipped myself off, so let me see if I can't avoid detection here. Again, the London police, you see them here, they've got their nightsticks, their truncheons, but again, many of the Metropolitan Police at this time would have been armed, with some sort of knife, maybe a sword in some cases, or even a gun. Most of the guns were used by the detective force, the plainclothes detectives in particular. We have a pretty good portrayal of a plainclothes detective in this game. Frederick Abeline is a member of the Metropolitan Police who works with the assassins to take out the Templars. And Aberline is one of the more famous Metropolitan Police detectives. He's somebody...
It'll all be over in the blink of an eye.
You can't get all of us.
You just worry about you.
This crowd's a powder keg, and I'm...
It's gonna take a while if I have to move all these guys, but Aberline is one of the bases for the character of Sherlock Holmes. He's somebody who uses... he's a plainclothes detective. He uses disguises in order to make his way into... various areas within the working class community, and the first moment you see him in this game, he's wearing an outfit that he's dressed as an old woman. So that one is one of his more favorite. I think I am stuck. Let me see if I just can't knock this guy out. There we go. Alright. So we've gotten one. And we got to make it past these police officers. We're not supposed to kill them in order to achieve full synchronization, as they say in Assassin's Creed jargon. And he is taking his sweet time. All right, let's make our way to the next troublemaker. I think I'm just gonna knock these guys out. I don't particularly care about full synchronization. Oh boy, well, I just got Karl Marx shot. Well, that's the end of the communist revolution right there. Marx is dead. So I guess I can't believe that. I can't believe that they didn't give me a chance to take out that guy. That is really annoying. Okay, I'm gonna give this another shot, and if it doesn't work out, then I'm gonna stop. That is really unfortunate. What an annoying mission to have to kidnap four guys in a crowded area. All right, where do we start? Okay. Oh, good. It's picked up. It must have auto-saved after I took out the first guy. So, thank goodness. It's actually, we're missing a pretty good Karl Marx speech here. Sounds like it's lifted directly from Communist Manifesto, actually.
Hands on! Where did you come from? My arm doesn't work like that. Are you mad? If any of my friends see you, we'll stop shooting.
It'll all be over in the blink of an eye.
Let's see, I don't think I should go this way. There's a lot of police over there. I'm gonna try to go to the left.
Go on, cause a fuss. Give us a reason to kill Marx.
I prefer a
more. So we got a question. What do you think is the most important thing to get right in historical fiction? I mean, from my standpoint as a historian, I think the most important thing to get right is what I would call the sensibility of the age. And it's kind of a nebulous term, but what I mean by that is I think it's really important to get the feel of the historical era. Because, you know, of course, because it's fiction, you know, people are going to take incredible liberties with it. You're going to have, you know, Dickens. You're going to run into Dickens. You're going to run into Darwin and whatnot. You know, I think even though you're going to take historical licenses in historical fiction, you you know, you've got to at least be true to the general trends of the era. So, for instance, you wouldn't have a version of Victorian London that, you know, had some sort of anachronistic technology placed in it. You wouldn't have some historical figures acting out of type, you know, so for instance having Karl Marx being a serial killer or something like that. And, you know, I would say a lot of historians, they have a lot of trouble with historical fiction. They don't want anybody to you know, mess around with, but check out this broom here, what is going on there? Anyways, you know, a lot of historians have a problem with people playing around with the historical record at all. I'm not one of those historians. I think, you know, it's fine to create historical fiction, but I would just ask that people get the sensibility of the age. They kind of understand that you are playing around with certain historical ideas, historical tropes, but you're not completely subverting those ideas. So, again, not making Karl Marx into a serial killer, not making Marx into some sort of, or making other historical characters into something they really weren't. So, that's what I would say. Get the sensibility of the age. Unfortunately, I spend so much time talking that I'm not paying attention to how I'm playing this level. See if I can't get over to this ledge. One good thing about almost getting caught there. Now I've got to defend Marx while all of this stuff is going on. Good lord! There's a lot of guys here. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this. There's way too many guys. I'm sorry, Carl. I'm trying my best. They're not attacking Marx anymore. That's a good thing. Oh, no. Oh. Well, I think that does it for the stream. Thanks for joining me. I've managed to get Karl Marx killed twice. It's not on purpose, not some sort of political statement on my account. But I hope you enjoyed the stream. I will be streaming more of my gameplay later this weekend. And probably going into some of the main story missions. But I hope you got something out of it. Please, if you're not familiar already, I run a YouTube series called History Respawned. Covers history video games. So if you're interested in more coverage like this, please go and search History Respawned on YouTube. All right. Thanks for your time.